I think I'm going to start. So I'd just like to say welcome to everybody. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening for this inaugural seminar of the Centre for Early Modern Studies at the Australian National University. I'd like to begin by acknowledging the traditional owners of the lands on which we at ANU meet today, the Ngunnawal and the Ngambri people, and to pay my respects to elders past, present and emerging. My name's Rosalind Smith, and I'm the Director of the Centre for Early Modern Studies at ANU. And I'd just like to say a few words about the centre before we start. This is the official launch of our centre, which we're very excited about. It's a relatively new centre, which brings together scholars from across the university who study the long early modern period, from the disciplines of history, art and design, literary studies, theatre and performance history, languages, linguistics, and the digital humanities. We currently have 17 staff members and rising, and 12, soon to be 13 HDR students. And I think we are a really exciting, genuinely cross-disciplinary group of researchers committed to scholarship of the early modern period. We have 4 active externally funded grant projects supported by over $2 million at present. And our shared research interests include mobility, gender, material cultures, and the digital humanities. We've also just been made a university research centre, and I'd like to thank our College Dean, Ray Francis, the Assistant Dean Research, Carly Message, Director of the RSHA, Paul Pickering, and my Head of School, Katie Sutton, for their fantastic support in this project, in this process. We're one of only 4 in our college. And it's an exciting kind of place to start for us. So the seminar today kicks off the Centre's externally facing program of events that we hope to build upon across the next 5 years. And I'd also like to thank Centre members Julie Hotchins and Christina Clark for volunteering to organise this seminar program. And in doing so with such astute judgment, grace and sense of fun. And to Julie Robarts, the research assistant who works for the centre, for all her assistance behind the scenes to make the event a success. And thank you all for being here. We've had over 140 people register for this, this talk and for what promises to be a fabulous talk by Professor Wiesner-Hanks, one of the giants of our field, who we're very privileged to have here today, and for this exciting first event for our centre. I'm now going to hand over to Julie Hotchins, who's the convener for the seminar.
Thanks very much, Ros, and welcome everybody. It's my great pleasure today to introduce Merry Wiesner-Hanks, who is Professor Emerita at the University of Wisconsin-Madison, with which she's had a long association. Merry will no doubt be familiar to many of you as one of the most influential scholars who shaped our understanding of the early modern world and beyond. And it's a real delight that you could join us today, Merry, to launch our seminar series. From her first monograph on working women in Renaissance Germany, to her groundbreaking book on women and gender in the early modern world, and to her recent edited collection titled Challenging Women's Agency and Activism in Early Modernity, Merry's research has demonstrated her commitment to place women and gender at the heart of historical developments and to study women as actors in their worlds. The breadth of her interests and intellectual curiosity is also evident in her focus on comparative approaches and global history, in which she has been instrumental in placing questions about gender and sexuality at the centre of how we understand the multiple border crossings and exchanges of global history. And her global scope is reflected too in her editing projects, such as the multi-volume Cambridge World History and the current project on the Cambridge World History of Sexualities. Today, however, Merry's going to talk to us about her recent book, What is Early Modern History? And it's hard to think really of someone better placed to write this introductory survey. This slim volume is a remarkable distillation of the breadth of themes and approaches to the field, coupled with a keen attention to the human dimension of the impacts of historical change, and it's written with an elegant concision. The subject of Merry's talk today is something that will resonate with all of us as she reflects on the challenges of writing a book during a global pandemic. But please join me in welcoming Merry Wiesner-Hanks.
Thank you, Julie, and thank you to everyone who's made this seminar possible. We were chatting before it officially started about what we're going to be keeping from COVID and what we're not going to be keeping from this. And at some point, we'll be able to come to Australia again, and Australians will be able to leave Australia and get back to Australia. We don't know when that is. But for now, these kind of substitutes seem to be working all right. So I'm going to talk to you about my book, What is Early Modern History? Way back in 2018, you know, in our former world, the editors at Polity asked me if I would be interested in writing this book. I've thought and sometimes written about early modern for a long time, first in discussions with other historians of women and gender, and then in discussions with other world and global historians. Both of these groups are rightly suspicious of meta-narratives, of which modernity is about as meta as you can get. But I found some of the other books in the series very helpful. Peter Burke's What is Cultural History was actually the very first. It's now in a third edition. This is the second. Barbara Rosenwein has one on What is the History of the Emotions. Jeff Weeks has one, What is Sexual History? And there's a bunch of others. And I thought they were good. I liked them. And I thought it might be fun to do. And it turned out that it was. It allowed me to think about why I had become an early modernist in the first place, which took me back to Philip Kintner's classes at Grinnell College in the early 1970s, from whom I first learned about historiography and the Renaissance. He taught me both of those. Some of the people he introduced me to are in the book, of course, Jakob Burckhardt, Leonardo Bruni, Max Weber, Peter Laslett. Some sections start with historiography I first learned in graduate school in the late 1970s with Robert Kingdon at the University of Wisconsin-Madison. And I should say I'm at Milwaukee, not Madison, but I graduated from Madison. People then, Norbert Elias, Heiko Obermann, Heinz Schilling, and a bunch of other Germans. Natalie Davis introduced me to theory. I met her while I was a grad student, which at that point, theory in the 70s was coming from anthropology, not literature, and to the Inaugural School, which became one of the anchors for the social history section in the book. But there are also many types of history in the book that didn't exist in the 1970s. The history of the body, the emotions and the senses, material culture history, trans history, crowdsourced digital history projects. No matter what aspect of life historians investigate, I discovered as I was doing this, they are likely to see the roots of modernity there, or of multiple modernities, varied and contingent on culture and historical circumstances. In exploring these new directions, as I wrote it, I was able to reach out to many people for help, from Ewan Cameron, who is writing a book on Christian understandings of time, to my son Kai, who is an expert on Japanese video games of the Warring States period, which featured in the chapter on popular and public history, along with the Louis Da Vinci exhibit, Hilary Mantel, Hamilton, and assorted heaving Tudor bosoms, male and female. So what I thought I would do now, I can't say tonight or this morning because it's something different for each of you, is I would walk through the book so you can just see how I decided to arrange things, and just I'll discuss some of the issues that emerged as I was writing. My aim was to sort out what Randy Starn has called the early modern muddle and to introduce readers to key topics and theories in the field. So it surveys various subfields of history, discussing the marks of modernity that have traditionally been seen as emerging in these, and the ways in which those marks of modernity have been questioned, nuanced, and rethought. The book is designed in part for students, so I try to relate the issues and concerns in early modern studies both to developments within history as a discipline, so they could kind of see the larger picture of that, and also to their own lives. Right. So that's what we're going to do, is kind of walk through the book. The first issue I confronted was what to do with the Renaissance. So is it part of the early modern? They don't have What is Renaissance History, so I couldn't just say, oh, there's another book about that, see that book. Wouldn't work. So is it part of early modern? Is it a prelude? Is it a bridge? Is it something else entirely that I should just say they should write a book about it? So I had originally thought that it would be in a chapter that I'd planned on intellectual and cultural history, which is basically how we frame the Renaissance today as a kind of cultural movement, intellectual kind of thing. But then religion got added to that chapter and it just didn't fit very well anymore. So I decided I would just take it head on and I start with it in the introduction. All right. This is about the Renaissance. That makes Petrarch the first scholar mentioned by name and Leonardo Bruni the first historian that readers meet. Now those humanists, you know, Petrarch and Bruni and the rest of the humanists don't call their own era modern, of course, but they call it new, which I thought that's close enough. So I started with them. And I sort of explain when new became modern and how the Middle Ages became the Middle Ages. Then I talk about what periodization is as a practice, how we do it all the time in our own lives as well as in our studies of history. The rest of the introduction talks about the invention of early modern, that term, its spread and the various critiques of it. I think Lynn Thorndike was the first to use it, the term, in 1926. Although, as with all origin stories, there may be an earlier instance. That's what happens all the time. The Annales school didn't like it, as it posited a break smack in the middle of their long durée, and neither did and do many medievalists who critique what Lee Patterson has termed the crude binarism that locates modernity, us, on one side, and pre-modernity, them, on the other. You have lots of other quotes from medievalists about how awful early modern is. Despite the fact that he added the first series with early modern in the title, J.H. Eliot didn't much like it either, noting that the term, he says, runs the risk of suggesting that the period is no more than a staging post on the road to contemporary society. Randy Starn, in that article about the early modern muddle, comments the term is, quote, saddled with a teleological modernizing directory and formed by the backfill from the debris of the collapsed breakthroughs to modernity that had not quite come about. Now, Starn, of course, is early modernist, so it's like, okay. So, along with being teleological and totalizing, modernity and modernization in their early versions are also often explicitly or implicitly Western, and connected with colonial domination. Reflecting sentiments that are widely shared, Leonard and Barbara Andaya, historians of Southeast Asia, comment, especially in the light of subaltern writings that reject the notion of modernity as a universal, the very invocation of the word implicitly sets a modern Europe against a yet to be modernized non-Europe. The world then joins Europe, the world beyond Europe joins the Middle Ages as kind of a them compared to us, consigned to what Deepesh Chakravarti has called the waiting room of history, you know, kind of on the same path, but not yet arrived. I talk about reservations that historians of areas beyond Europe have with the term, but also explain that increasing numbers are using it, which is why I can have a chapter on the global early modern. Okay, so that's all, that's the introduction. That's pages 1 through 8. Because early modern began as a concept in economic history, Chapter 1 surveys economic and social history of the era. So Chapter 1 is social and economic history. The economic history section starts with the Italian philosopher and diplomat Giovanni Botero, who began, I think, as the first to sort of conceptualize power, not just in military terms, but demographically and economically. There's also, you know, Adam Smith, Marx, the British Marxists and their history from below, and Franklin Mendels and his concept of proto-industrialization. I try to emphasize here that along with studying how capitalism and industrialism emerged, historians have been interested in why capitalism and then industry developed, when and where it did, and that explanations have tended to be either kind of spiritual, intellectual, or material. What my friend David Buck, was a historian of China, calls the pluck versus luck division in that, kind of the rise of the West. Max Weber and neo-Weberians like Jan de Vries and Joel Mocker are kind of in the pluck side. And the what's usually called the California school of Ken Pomerantz, Bin Wang, and others are on, kind of on the luck side. I started my career as a historian, as Julie said, a historian of women's work. And lately there's been a very interesting debate about the role of young women's work in economic expansion, kind of the role of young women in the rise of the West, what Jan Luten van Zand and other people at Utrecht call girl power. They have a map about it. It's in pink, by the way, which my students think is great. They see girl power as important both in the great divergence, the rise of the West, and the little divergence of Northwestern Europe from the rest of Europe. So that's in the economic history section. The economic history section ends with a discussion of consumer revolution and subfields of this, including food history and the history of fashion. Now, these could have gone in the sections on social and cultural history, of course, but I wanted to put it here to stress that consumption is part of the economy. My students understand this really well, and I think they sometimes understand it better than some economic historians do, who seem to be really like always still focused on production all the time. They can't turn away from it. Marxists and anti-Marxists, they all just talk about production all the time. I also, when I write books, I try to explain the cover image somewhere. So that's where it's here. The cover image, if you can see it, is a pocket compass sundial from the late 18th century It looks very snazzy, but it's actually a wooden knockoff of a much more expensive brass instrument. So it's sort of the early modern equivalent, as I say, of a kind of imitation Rolex watch. It's populux, it's not luxury. Okay, so that's the economy. The social history section of chapter one starts with the Inaugural School, especially Braudel, and the Cambridge Group for the History of Population and Social Structure and other historical demographers. Here's Hagenell's theory about differences in family patterns between Northwestern Europe and other places, a theory I think that seems to have stood the test of time pretty well. I talk about computer-assisted data analysis and mention Maria Ogren's really insightful new verb-oriented method of measuring work. And she's gone through and measured all every verb that talks about work in basically every early modern Swedish source that exists. It's just a really completely new way of thinking about it. I've got to go back and rewrite my first book. Then it's more sort of qualitative social history, family history, you know, and that dumb old idea that people in the past were indifferent toward their children, an idea most of my students picked up somewhere along the line, and I just want to shake them and say, this is not true, but I still have to refute it. So here's also Norbert Elias in The Civilizing Process, which serves as a way to move to the history of the body, which is here in the social history section. I needed to put the history of medicine and health somewhere, and a lot of this is kind of, these are kind of subfields that are now so interdisciplinary and reaching across subfields. You think, well, they've got to go somewhere, but they could have gone in anywhere. So I put it here, but I touch on intellectual as well as social issues, how historians of medicine study the ways that health, illness, and bodily process were understood as well as how they were experienced. That led fairly easily to the history of the senses, a sort of new interdisciplinary field in which historians and art historians and historians of science and medicine, literary scholars and musicologists and philosophers are now kind of looking at touch, smell, sound, other aspects of sensory culture. That chapter ends with the history of the emotions, you know, Barbara Rosenwein and Susan Carrant Nunn, and that new stuff. Okay, so there's chapter one. Chapter two, which is religious, intellectual, and cultural history, tackles kind of the old war horses of the West's modernizing trajectory, the Reformation, the Scientific Revolution, and the Enlightenment. I started writing this book and kind of thinking about this book and then writing it right after the Lutherjahr of 2017. So I was fresh from like a jillion Luther events, at one of which you and Cameron gave a fascinating paper about when what Luther did first became known as the Reformation. Spoiler, it's late 17th century. He's writing a new book about that. But it was really very interesting. Like, when did it become a thing? The Reformation with a capital, not just reform or something. I talk in that chapter then about how the Reformation has become longer, less theological, and now includes Catholics. And I also talk about the focus on confessionalization, social discipline, and popular religion. Because I discussed the Renaissance in the introduction, the intellectual history section starts with the Scientific Revolution, which is a term that only emerged in the 20th century. So I try throughout to try to point out when the terms that people use to talk about these things, because this is a book about periodization, when they emerge and who came up with them. So it starts with the Scientific Revolution and the whole kind of current debate about whether there really was a Scientific Revolution. That morphs into a consideration of the Republic of Letters, Habermas's idea of a public sphere, that kind of new institutional context of scientific and literary societies, journals and newspapers, clubs, coffee houses, salons. That's the genesis of the Enlightenment, which I trace from kind of its initial focus on rich men in France, to a movement that's now broader, less cohesive and multi-centric with ideas kind of flowing in all directions. So the Enlightenment is everywhere now in really interesting ways. The cultural history section of that chapter includes a really brief overview of works in the history of kind of culture, you know, art, architecture, music, literature. It's just tiny, which is where I decided that the material term fit best. I was trying to figure out should that go in social history and I ended up putting it here. One of the readers of the manuscript, the first version, pointed out that I hadn't included anything on the history of the book. Eek! You know, a fairly big gap. And especially as Polity has a whole one of these books. God, what is the history of the book? So I thought, ooh, they wouldn't appreciate if I left that out. So that went here. you know, it had to be there somewhere. The rest of the section is kind of cultural history as an approach rather than a specific type of subject matter. So here are people like Nellie Davis, Peter Burke, Carlo Ginsburg in microhistory, and then, you know, the linguistic cultural turn, which, because it's over, I could now shrink to four paragraphs. I've written over the years lots of introductions to things, and when we were in the middle of stuff, when in the middle of the history of the cultural turn, I had to spend four pages explaining the cultural turn, and now it's over, and so it can be short. Okay, so that was the cultural turn, but it had to be there. Okay, chapter three, those chapters one and two, chapter three is titled Women's Gender and Sexuality Studies instead of History. There's so much of the scholarship is interdisciplinary, that's the name of the key journal in the field, and I wanted to, it highlights the interdisciplinary of it. There I discuss the shift from women to gender, a little bit about intersectionality, the development of the history of sexuality, LGBTQ history and trans history. The section on women in that starts with Joan Kelly, of course. How could you write a book about periodization and not start with Joan Kelly? You know, that question, did women have a renaissance, got us all kind of thinking about periodization 77 was. That section about women discusses what I kind of see as the two main directions in women's history, kind of women's role in historical developments and the effects of these developments on women. That's kind of the two traditional directions, plus some new things are coming out like women's letter writing networks. In gender, the gender section, I talk about debates about female rule and about gender difference. So the Querelle des Femmes, all the various crises of masculinity that scholars have proposed in the early modern period. I mentioned the issue of whether early modern makes sense as an era in women's and gender history. Judith Bennett and I have been having debates about this over the years. And conclude that, well, you know, the early modern period in my book started with Christine de Pizan's 1405 City of Ladies. It ended with Mary Wollstonecraft's 1792 Vindication of the Rights of Women. So that's the beginning, that's the end. So at least in Europe, it works. That's what I would say. Okay. The section on sexuality in that chapter looks first at hereditary dynasties and all those wars over procreative failures that happened in the early modern period, you know, the Spanish succession, the war, the Austrian succession, the Bavarian succession. So politics kind of gets in here a bit. I've been struck by how sometimes people don't think that politics and sexuality fit together. The Habsburgs understood it, and we should understand it too. Then it tackles Foucault and the whole kind of modern sexuality debate. Some scholars, you know, see a change in the 18th century, have been proposing kind of the beginning of modern sexuality in the 18th century. In general, though, kind of looking this stuff over, the 19th century still emerges as a time of, the, you know, what Eve Sedgwick just called the great paradigm shift. Thus, I think, and I've written about this before at greater length, in sexuality, we early modernists tend to be kind of lumped in with the medievalists, part of that great pre-modern unwashed or unsexualized, which kind of makes us uncomfortable. it's like, ooh, I don't know. But we can't figure out something of sexuality that really happened around 1500, so maybe it is all pre-modern. You know, I think partly it's, you know, we're attracted to certain periods for certain reasons, and how fast things appear to change is one of the reasons we become early modernists, if we're early modernists. So it's like, well, we don't want to be in long periods of time. Okay, but it's true in sexuality. All right, so that's that chapter. Chapter four moves beyond Europe, examines the growth of the Atlantic world as a unit of study. It surveys sort of changing views of the map makers and scholars who never left Europe, but just contemplated the world, and the explorers and others who did leave Europe. It discusses Albert Crosby's ideas of the Columbian Exchange and ecological imperialism, both of which have been very fruitful. And fruitful is a metaphor, but it's also not, because a big chunk of Atlantic history has been food history in interesting ways. Sidney Mintz's classic kind of Sweetness and Power, which is a very early week, if we want to think about it that way, in food history, leads into a discussion in this chapter of slavery and the slave trade. One of the things I think we can't repeat often enough about our era is that from at least those of us who are, live in the United States, but I think all of us, is that from 1500 to 1850, at least four times as many Africans crossed the Atlantic than Europeans. Current estimates that I've seen are 12 million versus 3 million. So, you know, I try to say that again and again. When I'm teaching this, I point students who don't believe this to the wonderful open access transatlantic slave trade database with this information on and documents from 36,000 individual slaving expeditions. And I mentioned that in the book as well. So that's sort of there. Okay. That chapter looks at the processes of colonization and creolization, highlighting some studies that are comparison or that pay attention to African, indigenous, and mixed race people, including the women among them, as important agents. And there's more and more and more of these all the time. You know, John Thornton, Alan Greer, Jennifer Morgan, Matt Resto. This is what for Latin America has kind of been dubbed the new conquest history, or if it's people who focus on religion, the new mission history, which stretches connections, entanglements, accommodation, and blending, not just conquest and resistance. Creolization was not just a cultural process, but also a bodily one, as heterosexual relationships across ethnic and racial lines produced blended families and children of mixed ancestry. So here's where I introduce racial hierarchies and issues surrounding race, which, in my opinion, despite various attempts to push this back into the Middle Ages or even the ancient world, I think that our understanding of race can still be viewed as an early modern concept. And I know people may disagree with that, but you know, another origin story, as far as I know, and as far as I know from people who know this stuff well, the first use of the word white to talk about people was in a 1661 census in the British West Indies, a usage that spread to Virginia by 1691 and then throughout the British colonies. So maybe people have found an earlier example, but that's the earliest one that I know. So there's an early modern origin of that term. All right. As I conceptualize the book and kind of put things together, at some point I realized I didn't have a chapter on political history. Oh no. I blame this on the fact that I started as a historian of the Holy Roman Empire. You know, I started in Germany, which never fit very well until, you know, the big early modern political story, which is the rise of the nation state. You know, if I'd been a Tudor Stuart historian, there'd be a chapter on political history, I can guarantee it. So I toyed around with, should I add one? But then I'd have to cut back on something else. So I decided I'm just not going to do it. I would integrate the political story into various other chapters. So some of it's in sexuality, and some of it is in then this chapter on the Atlantic world, where I talk a little bit about nations and nationalism. This is where Benedict Anderson gets in. But I end up focusing more on the Atlantic revolutions, the American, the French, and the Haitian, as there's really been such wonderful work on these that sees them as transatlantic struggles for liberty and citizenship connected in complex ways. That also allows me to talk about what people have kind of seen at the end of the early modern. As I think politically, these revolutions are often sort of viewed as creating a truly modern political world. So it's like, okay, this is the end of the early modern. Okay, that's where they ended up in there. Okay. Chapter 5 widens the scope further still, surveying work that explores topics that are increasingly being investigated on a global scale. So there's global stuff in all of the earlier chapters. The Great Divergence Debate is in the economics section, you know, the sexualities and things, but this is kind of more things brought together. So that chapter begins with scholars who first use the term when they're talking about places beyond Europe: Anthony Reed, the Andayas, Zevalin Roski, Sanjay Subramaniam, Victor Lieberman. And they're kind of notions of strange parallels and multiple modernities. Then I look at work on interactions among people and cultures through travel, migration, networks, the circulation of objects and ideas. As with political history, I knew military history had to go somewhere. I couldn't just write the book about that. Especially as scholars counting wars and their duration and intensity have found that perhaps only 1 year in 10 was war-free in many areas in this period. But people have expanded Michael Roberts' notion of kind of a military revolution beyond Europe, so it fit quite well in this global chapter. So military history is in the global chapter, as did new work on both European and Islamic empires and the parallels between them. Some scholars have in fact taken to calling the Seven Years' War the First World War, because it involved conflict in North America, the Caribbean, the Pacific, and India, as well as Europe. Military historians also have their own version of kind of the Great Divergence Debate, with some scholars seeing European military superiority starting in the 16th century, that's Jeffrey Parker, others centuries later, Tony Andrade says the 18th century, and other people even the 19th century. Chapter 5 ends with environmental history, and the impact of environmental change, especially the Little Ice Age, along with the broader intersection between humans and the natural world, including what John Richards called the world hunt for beaver, seals, and fish in this period. All right. Okay, well, the world hunt is pretty depressing. So the end of chapter 5 is pretty depressing. And I hope chapter 6 is a little less so. This is the chapter that explores popular and public presentations of the period and how these have changed or not in the last several decades as the result of new research, changing public interests, new technologies, and other factors. Early modernist is a term that doesn't really enter public consciousness. When you say it to people who are not in the academia, they never know what you're talking about. They think you're maybe talking about the 1920s or something, at least when you kind of compare it with the Middle Ages or the Renaissance. Despite the fact people don't know the period, that period label, I've been struck by the huge amount of popular history of that period, you know, real, fictional, somewhere in between. It's available as books, films, television programs, websites, blogs, podcasts, web comics, video games, other forms of media, all this. That is all sort of augmented by specialized museums, historical houses, other buildings, gallery displays, tours, reenactments, fairs, and banquets, and other sort of physical and participatory public history offerings. This was really the most fun chapter in terms of doing my research, because I had great fun trying to get an overview of all this stuff. I sat through the various Sexy Tutors TV series, you know, it's kind of like, oh, Jonathan Rhys Davies and this people and that people, to the strategy board game Here I Stand, which is a board game about Martin Luther, that several of the students were in my Reformation course who were ex-cops and FBI all play together. So I went to their house on the weekend and sat down for 8 hours to play a video game about Martin Luther, just like with these ex-cops, to, you know, kind of the sealed knot reenactors of the English Civil War. I'd already gone to Renaissance fairs a lot when my kids were little, so I knew those. I didn't have to reacquaint myself with them, but these board games. I was also really fortunate a couple of years ago to be able to spend some time with the curators of the Europe 1600 to 1800 galleries at the V&A, which reopened in 2015 after a redesign that took several years. So I got to walk around with them. It was just wonderful. I got to see and talk to them about how museum professionals incorporate newer directions in early modern history, including a kind of social history emphasis on ordinary people. They have used tea towels. It's fabulous. And in many ways, the kind of Europe was connected with the rest of the world. So that chapter sort of suggests that what is early modern history is not just a question that matters to historians, but also to the wider public, who actively engage with the era through everything from juggling at a Renaissance fair to singing madrigals to transcribing recipes. So, as you can see, I divided the books into types of history, but kind of what ended up interesting me most are places where these intersect, including what could be a kind of new moniker for the era that I talk about in the environmental history section. And I'd like to just read you a little bit before I turn to kind of my afterword and what happened with COVID. This is about beaver. The world hunt for beaver provides another example of the ways many types of history intertwine. Hatmakers in Europe prized beaver fur for men's hats because the inner fur was dense and had small barbs, so it could be easily felted and formed into hats of different shapes and then brushed to a glossy sheen. Demand was so high that by the 17th century, European and Siberian beaver had been nearly hunted and trapped to extinction, and traders turned to North America. The demand for beaver fur was a major factor in the Iroquois Wars of the 17th century, which are sometimes called the Beaver Wars, in which the nations of the Iroquois Confederacy of the Eastern Great Lakes region of North America expanded their area of control, taking land from the Algonquins, the Wyandots, and other groups. The Iroquois appear to have been expansionists before the fur trade gave them an added incentive for warfare, but now the stakes were much higher, and the weapons more deadly, as the Dutch and later the English supplied them with guns. The Iroquois may have also been attempting to capture individuals from other tribes to replace the many in their own, who had died from warfare or other diseases brought by Europeans, especially smallpox and measles. They later became important combatants in the Seven Years' War, allies of the British against the French. European traders brought goods of interest to both men and women, including guns, rum, cloth, kettles, beads, flour, needles, and tea. Europeans only wanted fur, however, hunted and trapped by men, which made men's activities more highly valued among Native Americans than women's horticulture. At the same time, Native American women who married French fur traders served as cultural intermediaries, constructing mixed-race kinship networks that facilitated the trade in furs and other goods. Thus, without much effort, we can see economic, social, cultural, material, women's, gender, medical, technological, food, political, military, imperial, and environmental history in the Iroquois Wars. All of this sparked by men's fashion. The fur trade had such a broad impact, in fact, that we could perhaps rename the early modern period the beaver hat period, as beaver hats went first appear in the late 14th century, references to them, and beaver hats went out of style in the early 19th century, replaced by ones made of silk. So, will beaver hat period replace the early modern era? Probably not, but I might write a book explaining why it could at some point. The book ends with a brief afterword about where the field might go from here. I use as the base some of the 50 essays that we editors of the 16th Century Journal commissioned for the journal's 50th anniversary issue in 2019. Gary Gibbs, our book review editor, came up with the title Taking the Temperature of Early Modern Studies for this issue. We noted that taking the temperature is a metaphor that came from the worlds of baking, medical examination, and meteorological practices, and further noted all three of these have certain traits in common, that is, medicine, baking, and meteorology. The idea that something is in flux, that without proper monitoring, a situation could spin into something undesirable, and that proper monitoring is required as a matter of course. As that issue went to press, you know, way back in 2019, we thought that the Meteorological Association would have the most resonance. And indeed, climate change appeared in several of the essays as something that linked the early modern period and our own, and as something that would certainly have an impact on early modern studies along with everything else in our lives. You know, but as I actually wrote the afterwards, so that's what I thought I was going to talk about. In the spring of 2020, working from home under a shelter in place order, medicine had of course become what mattered most. And taking people's temperatures was a practice that occurred regularly all over the place. The three traits that we identified were chillingly pertinent. Everything was in flux. There was no proper monitoring, and the situation did spin into something undesirable. Places where there was monitoring, as a matter of course, or that adopted it quickly, were doing the best. Plus, everyone was suddenly very interested in past pandemics, including those from our period. Okay. So in the afterword, I talk a bit about some of the early modern things that were showing up during quarantine, including chamber music from people's apartments, Shakespeare plays streamed at no cost, several of which were plays he wrote while much of London was shut down with plague outbreaks. I speculate about it, ways in which the pandemic would speed up trends already going on, including the move to digital technologies that allows me to sit in my house in Wisconsin and give this inaugural lecture in Sydney. The most insightful essay in the SCG anniversary issue comes from Our Literal Speed, which is a multi-person text and art undertaking located in Selma, Alabama. They call themselves Our Literal Speed. They suggest that Peter Bruegel's drawing of a ship being tossed on the River Scheldt might be an apt metaphor for contemporary academia, also a world of high risk and uncertain journeys. They remind readers that to take the real temperature of early modern studies, so the title of our special issue, is to think about the idea of temp, which comes from temporare, restrain in Latin. As so many talented early modernists, young and old, are temps, they're in temporary and contingent positions. Just as were many people in the early modern period, they are in constant mobility, motivated not by choice, but by economic and political uncertainty. I did the final page proofs for the book in September 2020, at the point where we had no idea what the periodization of the pandemic would be, or when after would be. Now I'm fully vaccinated, and 2 weeks ago, I got on a plane, you Australians I know well, for the first time in over a year, to be with my son in San Francisco for his wedding. My husband and I figured that if he and his now wife could stand being with each other 24/7 for a year, working from home in a tiny one-bedroom apartment with their cat, they have a very good chance of making it as a couple. So in some senses, I'm now in after, at least me in a sort of blue and purple state of the United States. But we shall see. Pandemics are something early modern people lived with as well as died from. And that might be our story in the future as well. So, What I try to do in the book is to examine the many areas of life in which historians and people in other fields have seen and sort of contested the roots of our modern world, and have seen and contested whether the centuries between the invention of the printing press and the French Revolution form some sort of coherent whole. And I do that in 50,000 words. I also hope a kind of broader issue, that the book demystifies periodization and helps readers to understand that this sort of clunky word is an interpretive act that we all do to make meaning of the past, including our own lives. We decide, usually after the fact, which changes mark dramatic breaks, which years form an intelligible grouping. We give these periods a name. I have now entered a new period, as I am now someone's mother-in-law, a status I've never had before. And I hope this period lasts the rest of my life. So thanks. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mary. Terrific. Terrific. Wonderfully rich insights into not just how you, what you were thinking about in putting the book together, but also a sense of creative freedom that you could choose what was important for you and how you then intersperse things through the book as well. Yeah, really giving, in terms of your overview of the period. I'd really, I'm sure people have got lots of questions and are really open for discussion. There's two ways, if you're interested to for questions, you can post a question through the question and answer function at the bottom of the screen, or please use the raised hand function. If you go into the participants and raise hand and then unmute when I invite you to speak, unmute yourself and ask Mary a question directly. That's what people are thinking. Roz, was there, do you have anything you'd like to add or comment on?
I can ask a question. One of the questions I was wondering, can you hear me? Yeah. One of the questions I was wondering is, it's a two-part question, actually. It's around the limits of the term early modern. So part of this is, what role does the global South play in thinking through that term early modern, and where its limits might be? So I can think of ways to think about early modern China, but how would you think about, for example, early modern in terms of, say, Australian Indigenous cultures? So that's one question. And then my other question is kind of the opposite. It's like, in the heart of early modern European cultures, to what extent does the early modern, or is Renaissance culture, I suppose, transmitted? So, you know, to what extent do non-elite, non-literate people experience early modernity? So that would be the other half of that question. One is about geographic limits, and the other is, I suppose, about limits, cultural limits.
Yeah. Basically, Indigenous Australia, I just assume, sort of not at all. Although the Global South is there a lot in the Atlantic World chapter, and here I think John Thornton has been the, and that whole sort of contingent of people really trying to say that the Atlantic World is a product of Indigenous people from the Americas and people from Africa. You know, it's a product of, it's not just Europe. So I think kind of, if we think about the Global South really being the South, that rather than kind of the metaphor that we use it for, that Africa is there in the Atlantic World chapter quite a bit, but the Indigenous people there as well. And then in some things, in the Global chapter, I think in environmental history, it emerges there again. But you know, in fact, when I write, I have my other book, my Early Modern Europe book, one of the things I say, well, can we use 1789 should I use 1789 as a way to end early modern? Doesn't that privilege political history? I mean, that's a book about early modern Europe. It's not a book, but it has global, it has global chapters in it in my early modern Europe book. You know, but it's also a question about, am I privileging some kind of political history of France if I say, like, I kind of end it in 1789. I say, but that's also like the first expedition to Australia, right? I mean, you know, it's just kind of like, I can see there's some other things. And that's also the 1780s, like, should I use 1780s instead of the 1800? But that's when you first, you know, that's when you can't send convicts to North America anymore because of the American Revolution, and so you ship them off to Australia. So like new patterns of migration start up in the 17, there's other things that happened in the 1780s. It's also the end, it's Cartwright's invention of the loom. So there's some other stuff that I can say. The 1780s work as a time to end things. Mm-hmm. It's not just the French Revolution. So I think that's partly that. And so there isn't an Indigenous Australia really part in there other than in this kind of environmental history section, because it's not been there. You know, and one of the things that I think that somebody, when I'm doing a kind of seminar on this, that because it's a book on what people have written, it's historiography, it's not like what I wish people had written. I wish people had done more about that. Well, you know, nothing exists. So, and this is a question always in trying to do kind of balancing, I mean, 50,000 words, but trying to do balancing acts of reviews of historiography. You know, it probably isn't right that I didn't have a chapter on political history. If I count the number of things that I've written, or like what the balance of submissions that we get to the 16th century journal is, that I don't have a chapter in political history is kind of, but I just, you know, can find that out somewhere else. You can read lots of books on it. But again, trying to think about what you're doing is providing a fair, opinionated, but fair overview of what's been done. And it really can't, and it probably, you know, it's not fair in terms, you know, if I did a completely, an overview of what's been done with the balance of my pages based on what's been done, England would be three quarters of the book and Scotland would be an eighth. And, you know, I mean, it's just, you know, this enormous amount of work. So I tried to balance between here's where lots of scholarship has been and here's where other scholarship has been. And then kind of like the people who, for whom this is not, you know, kind of people who are not literate people who don't read and write. I mean, I started out, my first book was about working women, who, most of whom couldn't read or write, you know, so that they're all over the place. And I try to sort of talk about some of the ways that, so some sort of ways of that approaches that have used, that have looked particularly at people who are not among the elite, that aren't, don't really originate. I mean, kind of like, Scooch E.P. Thompson, and he's not really an early modernist, it's kind of a late early modernist, but you know, so it's like, well, he shouldn't really be there, it's not really about that. But I think that's that whole history from below thing involves so many people who looked at the early modern period, and so he's there. And because his way of conceptualizing also that this is something that involves culture of the working class, that I wanted to put in there. So they're there. As much as I can put them. And, you know, and women, you know, of course, it's me writing. Women are not just in the women's chapter, all over the place. You know, and I think, too, in the Atlantic World chapter, what's really been exciting is, and I have this book, Christianity and Sexuality, that I've just written, published a third edition of. I wrote it first 20 years ago. You know, at that point, most of the Latin American scholarship was all based in Spanish sources. And what's happened in the last 20 years, I mean, I don't know how to read Nahuatl or Quechua, but I can read books written by people who can read these sources in indigenous languages. And it's just so, the scholarship is so much more in depth right now, and it reflects indigenous viewpoints in ways that it just didn't 20 years ago. So that's been a really, really exciting development, I think, in kind of looking at that emerges kind of in this Atlantic World chapter. I mean, we just know so much more now.
We do, Thank you.
Thanks so much. I have a question here from Katie Sutton that I'd like to read out. Thanks for this wonderful presentation, Merry. I look forward to the book. I've been drawing on your work on gender and sexuality recently in thinking about these themes in modern Germany. Could you tell us more about how you deal with 20th and 21st century terminology, such as heterosexual, queer, trans, LGBT, in addressing these themes in the early modern past?
and, you know, I'm currently, Matt Koifler and I are editing a 4-volume Cambridge World History of Sexualities in the plural. That's what we're doing. So right now I'm thinking about this a lot. We're beginning to read, this is another interesting thing, is editing a giant project like this in the midst of COVID. So things have slowed down a little in that project because Some people actually turned their things pretty quickly because they thought they're going to be traveling and then they weren't. I said, oh, I might as well write this because I'm not going anywhere. And other people have had great difficulty, both personal circumstances and difficulty getting to be anything, and well as getting their heads in a place to write anything. So I think about these kind of issues a lot, and several of our authors are kind of considering those kinds of issues that when I use in this, luckily in this book, the central section is very short, so I don't have to, but I usually, in my own writing, I use the word same sex. I moved away from using homosexual. I don't usually like sodomy, although that's the word in the Renaissance, so I could use that. So I try to use these kind of terminologies, but also then, you know, point out to the way, I couldn't do this at length in this book, but in other things I've written, including the introduction to Christianity and sexuality. And that also, that's a book, again, I've written that over 20 years. So I did 20 years ago, when I had to explain in the introduction what a third gender person was, because most people had never heard of that. And they couldn't figure it. And I said, this is what it is. And this is how these work, you know, like this is new, because my students, you know, it's a book designed for students and they'd never heard of such a thing. Well, that whole section I could just chuck out because I didn't have to explain it anymore. And the terminology changed from when I wrote the second edition 10 years ago to when I'm writing now. I mean, what is now trans was at that point, I talked 10 years ago about, you know, transgender and transsexual and the difference between them, and now it's just kind of lumped into this. And so that I also say that terminology changes. For a while, you know, the LGBTQ plus initialization kept getting longer and longer, and that's kind of settled right now on LGBTQ plus. Some people are not happy with that. That's just, I said, these are terminologies that people have to understand that they kind of change. So for the purposes of this book, the most important thing for people to get in just this few stages on sexuality was this whole, I think, this whole debate about modern sexuality, because it's so prevalent. I mean, even for people like Cedric and people who kind of dispute it, I mean, Foucault is over everything. And so you just have to deal with that. And so I thought that's what, if there are people who've never known anything about that debate before, that's what they needed to know the most. And I think too, that's when you're writing something that's this short about this stuff, is it's kind of like, what's the most important thing for people to, sometimes I want to put in a few things about my like girl power because it's really interesting, but it's like, okay, this is designed for students, and it's designed for people, and partly for people who really don't know what is early modernist history. So you think, okay, they need to come away from it thinking, oh, okay, well, the most important thing about economic history or social history, I mean, here are the debates that have been, and you do have to balance my little joke about the linguistic cultural turn. I mean, that's true about everything that I used to, when I used to write introductions to theory, I would talk a lot about the Annales School, because when I started, that was like, that was theory and that was a big thing. And then, you know, it's kind of like, now it's kind of antiquated, people understand it in the past, but it still needs to be there, because if we think about how we got to theorizing we do today, we have to understand the Annales School. I mean, we just have to understand this kind of notion about how revolutionary it was to talk about the long delay and not just talk about political events, or how revolutionary, I mean, this is what happens with my students all the time. They go, oh, you know, why, geez, you know, like that women wrote something. I mean, this is kind of self-evident, right? Did gender socially constructed? It's self-evident. Well, it wasn't 40 years ago that women wrote something. It wasn't 40, you know, I mean, I had an archivist once in Stuttgart when I was working on what became my first book, you know, who just told me point blank, well, women didn't work in the city in the 16th century. you know, you won't find any sources here. Women didn't work here in the 16th century. You know, I go, okay, yes, thank you, sir. And then I just asked for certain, you know, the kind of sources I knew there would be women all over the place, and just let him go. You know, didn't pay attention to him. But so I think that's, you have to kind of reflect how fields have developed and use terminology that's reflective of how we are now, but also then kind of explain what were the origins of this kind of terminology? How did we come about to talk about that? Things that way.
Terrific, thank you. How you thought about the book, how you thought about the period, the opportunity to understand why, what's there, what's not where, and really get the sense of engagement and ways of thinking about, you know, early modern history and all of that it may or may not encompass. So I'd like everybody to join me in thanking you for a terrific seminar. And also I'd just like to briefly mention that our next seminar will be in September.